beach full of pebbles with the ocean washing over them, moving them around. Pebbles. And when you look closely at these pebbles, every single one of those pebbles is unique. Not one of them, not two of them are the same, are they? Every one is unique. So can we think about ourselves as pebbles? Every one of us is a pebble. Every one of us is a human being. But every one of us is unique. Okay, you can open your eyes now. Anybody fallen asleep? Okay, good. I'm a woman, first and foremost. And contrary to some popular belief, I always have been. But we're going to talk about that in a second. I'm transgender, it's true. I am. I'm also a trans woman. These two are somewhat synonymous, but not quite, because transgender really is that umbrella term of gender diversity. And I happen to be a lesbian. Really, I am, even though it's only there quickly. That makes it interesting too, actually, by the way, you know, to be both trans and to be lesbian. And I'm going to chat on that as we go through the session this morning. Okay, so my journey. In my memory, my journey kind of started around age 8. It might have been a little bit earlier than that, but I don't know. Anybody remember? Actually, you guys are cheating, really, because you've got an advantage over me. Age 8 wasn't that long ago, right? For me, it was a long time, trust me. Okay, so age 8. I was in denial. For all of my life, for most of it, right up until 2008, I was in deep, deep denial. I was confused. I had no information. I had no frame of reference. I knew I wasn't the same as everybody else. I knew I was a unique pebble, but I had no way of knowing about it. And we had no Google back then. Can you imagine life without Google? Like, really? Like, seriously? We had no cell phones, we had no internet. I would connect, if I wanted to get on the computer, I would connect to the local university via a dial-up modem line. Remember that? I bet many of you don't remember that sound. Okay. So I lived all of these years in denial. And I was good at it, by the way, right? Masquerading as I did all that time. So when I was born, you know, if we go back an inch or two here, a mistake was made. So when I was born, probably screaming my head off, I was a mighty 10 pounds, my poor mama. And when the nurse held me up, the nurse declared, "Mr. and Mrs. Emson, you have a healthy, bouncy baby boy." She was wrong. But at that time, she would have had no idea, A, that she was wrong, and B, why. And we're going to go through that and explore that in a second. I was bullied. I was bullied relentlessly. In fact, Michelle was used as a derogatory name for me. So it was used as a name of hatred, a venomous name, a name that people would throw at me to just embarrass me and shame me. That's why I took on the name, because I took that power back from that name. I hated that name for most of my life. And then I took it back, and now I love it. 2008, transition started. And I did a ton of research. I had Google available to me now. Now, I cannot emphasize enough the denial phase here, right? It was really deep. So then we got into some understanding. I spent 3 years looking for a cure. Can you imagine? I don't know what I was thinking. But I'll tell you why I was looking for a cure. Because at that point, I was married. I had 2 stepchildren, 6 grandchildren, as if that's not giving my age away. I had a house. I had a career. And as part of my transition, by the time I got to my new life in 2011, I lost all of that. I lost my entire family. I lost my house, I lost my career. Why? Because I'm a woman. I'm a trans woman. I'm a lesbian trans woman. And unfortunately, in a patriarchal society, I am now worth much less than I was masquerading as a boy before. So now I've stepped into my new life. I've stepped into my new self. I've stepped in to my authentic power. I'm no longer pretending to be somebody I wasn't. I'm done with that. I spent almost 40 years dressing up as a boy every single day. Can you imagine how tiresome that is? It sucked, I'm telling you. I'm liberated, I'm vibrant, and I've now become an advocate and an activist for all the pebbles out there that just want to be themselves. So Day of Pink. What's Day of Pink all about? Anybody know the history of Day of Pink? Anybody help me? Yes. Absolutely, absolutely correct. Anybody tell me where that happened? I kind of almost heard. Somebody want to shout that?
Canada.
Canada, it did, Nova Scotia. So absolutely, a grade 9 student in 2007 had the audacity to A, be gay, and B, come to school wearing pink. Bullied relentlessly, two students looked on and said, "This is not right." They were straight, cisgendered, heterosexual students, at least at that time. Who knows where their life took them afterwards? But at that time, as it's recorded in history, and they stood up. And how did they do that? They went out and bought pink shirts. And the following day, everybody, a whole bunch of friends, came to school in pink shirts and said, "You want to bully me for wearing a pink shirt? Bring it on." Right? Allies. I'm going to talk about allies in a second. So the objective of Day of Pink is to raise awareness to bullying, and largely bullying as a result of homophobia and transphobia. And latterly, it's come on to celebrate diversity and inclusivity. Let's embrace all the pebbles on the beach and exclude none of them. I believe it's also about building allies because, as I just said, it started as a result of two courageous allies who were prepared to stand up for what was wrong. And stand up is a bit of a theme here. Okay, so let's have a look at bullying. First of all, what is bullying? So a few definitions. It's the use of force, threat, or coercion to abuse, intimidate, or aggressively dominate others. The behavior is repeated and is habitual. So here's the thing. Somebody does one bad thing to you, right? Maybe they misgender you, maybe they call you a name. That's rude, right? They do it once, it's coming from this place, it's rude, and you kind of don't feel good about it, right? But maybe you walk on. Then maybe they come back and they do it again. Or maybe this time they really do it deliberately. Maybe the first time it was an accident, but second time they meant it. And that's mean, right? That's mean when somebody does that. But then they come back and they do it a third and a fourth and a fifth time. Worse, they post about it on the internet, right? They tell your friends about it. This is bullying. This is bullying. This is relentless, habitual, repeated behavior that is just not good. So it's abuse at the hands of our peers. Now, bullying doesn't always happen with peers, right? Sometimes we see bullying going on outside of our peer group. But most often, and particularly in the student population, you're going to see this coming from your peers, not least of which, because that's who you spend all your day with. It's about power. It's about that feeling that I need to have power over you. And it's about shame and it's about aggression. And it's just basically not nice. So what happens as a result of bullying? Anybody recognize some of these things? I'm not going to ask for hands here, right? Just look at a few of these things. It leads to isolation and loneliness. That was certainly my experience as I was being bullied through school, right? I just imploded. And I find myself on my own. I was isolated. I was lonely because I realized that there was something different about me that I didn't fit, right? And it also leads to social and mental health issues. We know this from the research we've done. Social anxiety issues. I would never go to a party. Here's a thing. Here's a strange thing that happened. Kind of as a result of that, anybody really kind of believe in energy work? I'm not heavy into energy work, but the concept that we are all energy and we feel energy, I can feel your energy, for example, today. So here's the thing. Back in the day, I would walk into a conference, maybe I'd walk into a room like this, and not one single person would talk to me. I might go to a networking meeting, I might go to a trade show, and there would be thousands of people, and everybody's talking to one another, and it's all bustling and happy. And I would walk out 2 hours later and probably haven't spoken to anybody. I was clearly giving off some kind of energy. I was experiencing a social anxiety that was being picked up subconsciously by the people around me. Ever since 2011, and I've been out, and I've been me, and I've stepped into my power, and I'm standing tall. Oh my gosh, such a difference. If I walk into a conference now, I'm usually the last person to leave. We usually get kicked out, right? Because we're just chatting, 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 chatting. Suicide. It happens. And all too often, it happens as a result of bullying, a result of homophobia, and a result of transphobia. So let's have a little look at homophobia. It encompasses a range of negative attitudes and feelings toward homosexuality or people who are identified as or perceived as being, and perception's a big one here, lesbian, gay, or bisexual. So sometimes you don't have to be LGBT. You just have to be perceived as being LGBT in order to be a victim of bullying. So let's look at, I think I've got an example coming up. Yes, I do. So in 2009, a Canadian climate survey on homophobia showed that 59% of queer high school students reported that they were verbally harassed, compared to just 7% of their non-queer peers. That's a huge difference. 25% of those queer students experienced physical harassment, and 31% reported that they got it digitally, via the internet, text and Snapchat and the rest of them, compared to just 8% of the non-queer students. Look at this disproportionate effect that's going on here, right? Just because they're a pebble. Here's another real-world example, Chechnya. Anybody familiar with Chechnya? Got some hands down here. Devastated, thank you very much. Chechnya is a tiny republic, part of Russia. Its borders have been in dispute for years. It's about the size of Nipissing, North Bay district. 17,000 kilometers, it's tiny, right? About twice the size of the GTA. But so much happens there, and we've got it going on right now. So over 100 to date, and this number is grossly understated, have been arrested and imprisoned in makeshift concentration camps. First time any state has used concentration camps since the war. And the Chechen government, this is the bad part, right? This is a really bad part, and we see this with Russia too. So the Chechen government insists that you cannot detain and harass someone who doesn't exist in the republic. So we see this in states all around the world where governments and state authorities deny the very existence of LGBTQ pebbles in their community. State-sponsored homophobia, state-sponsored bullying. And this is why I do what I do on an international stage. Let's have a look at transphobia. I've experienced a little bit of this. I think you could imagine. So transphobia is a range of negative attitudes and feelings towards transgender, transsexual people, or towards transsexuality itself. So the very concept that trans even exists, that any kind of dispute of gender binary norms even exists. It can be emotional, it can be disgust, it could be fear, anger, or discomfort felt or expressed towards people who do not conform to society's expectations of gender, right? So society has created this concept of a gender binary, simply one or the other. And we know that's just not true. Examples, so some statistics from GLSEN. So this is the United States Schools and Education Network. And it shows that 16% of transgender students report being physically assaulted as a result of their gender expression. It also shows that 32% of trans students experienced physical harassment. And here's an example. So each year we have a day that celebrates the lives lost to violence. Trans Day of Remembrance, it happens in December. I held an event here in Bracebridge for the first time. Since 2009, 2,343 recorded cases of murder as a result of transphobia. And I stress recorded, and here's why. For the most part, trans people, when they suffer this kind of violence, are either misgendered, misidentified by the authorities, or the authorities have no method by which they can rank these statistics. So they don't have a category for hate crimes around transphobia. And so we rely on volunteers worldwide to record these numbers. We know that number is way low. We know that number is so understated. It's a tragedy. It really is. The majority of these cases happen in South America, and unfortunately the majority of those cases occur as a result of sex work. And that's, you know, that's just sad. It's just sad. Here's something to think about. I love this. I live by this. I live by this every day of the week. You know, when we're thinking about bullying, when we're thinking about transphobia and homophobia, when we're experiencing these kind of things, what other people think of you is none of your business. And I'll tell you why. Because what they think of you is filtered by their lens. It's filtered by their lived experience, their core values. It's somewhat distorted by what they know as people, from how they've grown up, what they've experienced in their lives. And this applies to every single one of us, right? It's a universal mantra that, you know, whenever you're feeling, four agreements. Has anybody heard of the four agreements? Do we cover that at all? No, four agreements. I should have put a slide up for that. But one of the four agreements describes don't take anything personally. And it really talks to this. If we don't take things personally, then we're not going to feel those feelings of abuse and those feelings of bullying, right? It's not the act of bullying that's disruptive to us. It's the way that we receive it. So yes, we want to stop bullying from happening, but at the same time, we can also work on ourselves to stop receiving it. It's not easy, let me tell you, but it can be done. Okay, the path to acceptance. You know, International Day of Pink is really all about celebrating diversity, inclusivity, and raising awareness around homophobia, transphobia, and bullying. So how do we overcome some of that? Well, there's a path to acceptance, because fundamentally, if we can be accepted in society, amongst our peers, as of that unique pebble, you know, one that just shines, one that's gorgeous, one that's unique in every way, that would be acceptance. But where does acceptance start from? And it starts from visibility. If there's any minority that is invisible, that minority will never achieve acceptance. Because just like the Chechen government, we'll have people rise up and say, you don't exist. Right? And as a documentary filmmaker, I can envisage a shot here at the point that I'm talking about this, and that people randomly would disappear from out of the audience because of being an invisible minority. Now, it doesn't have to be LGBTQ, of course. Our invisible minority might be one of race, might be one of religion, of faith, right? There's a myriad number of ways that we can be unique and we can be an oppressed minority. So visibility is key. This is why I do what I do, right? I get up and I stand and I raise visibility and I leverage my presence on behalf of LGBTQ people everywhere. Because if we can just be visible, you know, visibility, I just keep showing up. There's a great campaign that's coming up, starting here in Muskoka, Just Show Up. It's run by a dear friend and author of mine, Yvonne Heath from Port Sydney. Just show up. And that's what I keep doing. I moved to Bracebridge in Thanksgiving of last year. But I just keep showing up. I show up at the grocery store. I show up at Timmy's. You know, and what happens then is people just get used to you and realize that, you know what, you're just a pebble. You're just a pebble like all the other pebbles. Visibility. It leads to awareness. People become aware. So maybe Muskoka population in general is not so aware about trans people. Maybe 1% has watched I Am Kate and kind of seen a little bit of that. Maybe they watched Gender Revolution with Katie Couric. Or maybe they bumped into me in the grocery store doing my shopping. And trust me, it happens. Awareness leads to understanding. Why? Because we're curious creatures. Right? So once our awareness has been piqued, once somebody's brought to our attention something that might be interesting, what do? We Google it. Or we talk to somebody about it. Right? Or we ask questions. We become curious. And we say, you know what? I need to understand a little bit more about this. What's going on? And I hope out of today's session, a few of you are going to go ahead and pick up a couple of points that I've mentioned, and you're going to go and take a look at it. And understanding will eventually lead to acceptance. There's a word that's missing here, and I really want to raise it, even though I don't want to put it up on the screen. And it's tolerance. There is no place in society for tolerance. Because tolerance says, I really don't like your pebble, but I'm not going to say anything about it, right? You know, whatever, right? Tolerance actually tends to be homophobia and transphobia and any other phobia that's somewhat hidden, two-faced. They'll say to your face, oh yeah, you're fine, you know, whatever, and then behind your back, whack. Tolerance is not a healthy place to be, and we skip entirely over it in my mission to get us to acceptance. So, reaching acceptance. Somebody accepts us for who we are, for who we truly are. Who are they? People who really accept us, right? Think about those two students who stood up on the original day of Pink. They were allies. Allies are critical. Allies do not belong in the marginalized group, whether it's LGBTQ or something else. Allies are not members of that marginalized group. Rather, they are external to that group and will speak out on behalf of, but more importantly, will stand up for any abuse of a marginalized group. We love allies. Awesome, I think we're doing good. Okay, so that's some generalized stuff around bullying, around transphobia, homophobia, things like that. Anybody have any questions before I move on to the next topic? Any questions? My gosh. So you're either all asleep, or you know all this stuff already. Good. Well, you know what? We'll have a Q&A at the end, okay? But feel free to ask a question. Put your hand up at any point during this, because this is going to get a little bit technical in a minute. And if you don't want to ask the question in public, I'm hanging around after the presentation. Feel free to stop by and ask me any question you like. And while I talk about questions, here's an interesting one. So this is another mantra. It's a statement that I use whenever I'm speaking to people. And it's that I will answer any question respectfully asked. Any question respectfully asked. If you're asking me just to be mean and just to poke at me, I'm likely to slap you upside the head, right? That's the first thing. But we really shouldn't talk about violence as a reaction to this. But any question respectfully asked, I will answer it. If it's too personal, I will tell you, and I will graciously decline to answer. So, respectfully asked. Let's talk gender. Anybody seen this? Nobody seen this? Gender-bred person? I've got a few hands. Come on. Let's just make sure everybody's awake here. Okay, gender-bred person. So, you know, historically we've had a bit of an issue when we're talking about gender, gender identity, gender expression, and so on. And this graphic showed up a few years ago on the net, and it's now at version 3.3. 3.3. And the reason it's at version 3.3 is because gender as a concept is fluid, and it changes. The language we use changes over time. It's not easy, but there's a couple of things that we can go through right here that will really kind of pull it down and get us thinking. So, basically, we have this concept of our gender-bred person. And it's a gender-bred person because it's gender-neutral. It's neither him nor her, it's neither other, right? It's just entirely unique, independent pebble of a gender-bred person. And what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at all of the component parts that go to make up our gender identity, our gender expression, and our sexual orientation. I'm going to start with the tricky place. I'm going to start with our anatomical or biological sex. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to be vulnerable. And I'm going to use myself as an example as we go through some of these things. But as I go through them, I want you to be thinking about yourself too. How would you rank? Where would you score? I don't need you writing this down, and nor do I need you sharing it. Just think about it in your head, right? But just follow along with me. Because the results may be surprising to a few of you as we go through this. So the first thing we're going to look at is biological sex. Now, as I described earlier, I was held up by the nurse, and without a doubt, I mean, there was no doubt, biologically, I was male. By quirk of nature, and I won't get into the science today, but by quirk of nature, physically, my physical form, my primary sexual characteristics were clearly male. That's not always the case, by the way. So, you know, we can look at this, and this is a bit of an eye chart, but I will suggest here that in my case, predominantly male, less femaleness in terms of my biological characteristics. And similarly, a cisgendered female, that is not a trans female, would be here with probably almost nothing down here. But there's an alternative here, and that is intersex. Intersex affects a good deal of the population, actually more than we might know. And it's a condition where the genitalia are somewhat ambiguous at birth. And this is a situation where, for example, a person may have both a penis and a uterus. We may have a penis and ovaries instead of testes. So this is the life that an intersex person has to deal with. And so it may well be that a person is born with a dot right here and a dot right here and need to deal with that. That's the subject I don't have time to get into today. But I would certainly encourage you to take a look at it because it's another oppressed minority that is almost invisible and is a bullied against. Actually, I'm going to bounce back from that real quick. Usually I can see my slides, but unfortunately due to tech here that I just couldn't do this. So that come across as a surprise. What I'm going to do, so I shot this film. Remember I mentioned transgender life in Slovenia? So I shot this film, and it explored the lived experiences of 10 young trans and non-binary people living through the country. And it was an interesting exercise, and they had some great things to say. So what I've done is I've peppered some of their answers to questions which relate to what we're talking about here. So let's hear what they have to say on the subject of biological sex.
Vprašanja, ki jih ne bi vprašali cis-spolnih oseb.
Nespremljivi komentarji se mi definitivno zdijo kot prvo o genitalijah, da se vsak utakne v to, kar se ga sploh ne tiče. In na splošno vtikanje v privatna življenja, v odnose med sebojne med nami, v naše partnerje, v naše zveze.
Ki sem dobila bradavice. Če čutim, če imam orgazem, če se vlažim.
A imam spodi oboje, kako ljubljam, kako spolno občujem. Če sem zdaj kaj drugačen, če so mi hormoni cmenili moj celo osebnost in mišljenje in svašta me naredil čist druga človeka. To, kad slišam, da je kar imam smešen. Zakaj grem pol na oba WC-ja, če jaz hočem biti moške, zakaj se tako oblačem, zakaj nisem bolj možvat, zakaj nimam, ne vem, brade. Tako je, te nekaj tipične, kar si tako ponovljajo na dan stokrat.
Ja, najbolj me moti, ker da jo vprašajo, kaj imaš pa ti v hlačah. Pač nisi fant, če nimaš to, ker mora imeti fanti. To je pač najbolj visoko me moti.
Komentarji, ki se mi zdijo nesprejemljivi za me osebno, so to, da mi nekdo reče, da nisem pravi moški, oziroma da to ne bom nikoli postal. Najbolj bi pa me zabolelo pri srcu, če me mama ne bi imela za pravega sina, sestra za brata. Ali brat za brata.
Kaj imaš med nogam? A si v resnici fanta ali punca? Sej, zihr si mu, če si ne bi naravno, zihr može biti nekaj od rojstva, tako nekaj to. Kaj je še bilo? A ja, kakšen si bil, kakšen si bil prej, z dolgimi lasi, če se da sliko videti, to troje bi bilo najbolj smešno.
Ne želim poslušati o tem, kako sem pol-pol. Ne želim poslušati o tem, da sem v bistvu ženska, ki hoče biti moški, ampak še vedno zgleda kot ženska. Jaz sem nebinarna oseba in to je to. Nič ženske, nič moškega ni pri tem. Pri tem je nebinarnost.
Skrbi me pa edino, da to poslušajo marsikdo, ko vzame te stvari osebno. Oziroma, tako kot jaz, ko sem bila otrok, pa sem to poslušala, pa mi je to povzročilo te strahove. Se dostikrat strašim, da to tudi marsikateri otroci, mladostniki ali pa tudi starejši še zmeraj doživljajo zelo
A couple of key messages came out of there, right? One really key one, my body is none of your damn business. Damn, oops, darned. None of your darn business, right? Oh my gosh, really? You know, my body, that's between me and maybe my intimate partner, but it's certainly nobody else's business. And that, you know, that goes whether you're cisgendered, whether you're transgender, whether you're non-binary, right? It is not polite to go up to a trans person of any age and ask them about surgery or ask them about their genitalia or ask them about their body any more than you would go up and ask one of your other friends. So that was a really key one. So let's take a look at the next step. So we've covered here the biological sex. I think we saw that.
Resnična, lepa, moja.
Nebinarna ali pa androgena, pa nekaj od tega. Z miksem skupaj.
Sproščenost, veselje in sreča.
Moja, nebinarna in spolno neutralna.
Svobodna. Zanimiva, pa nenormativa.
I love my friends. Gender identity. How do I identify as a person? How do I identify with my gender? So let's go back to me as an example. So we can take a look at our gender identity. With me, I know that my gender identity was female, right from a young age, from as far back as I can possibly remember, right? And remember that our gender identity is in our brain. Our gender identity is in our mind, it's in our spirit, it's in our heart. This is who I am, regardless of how I might appear in the world, which is expression, we'll get to that in a second. But gender identity is really about who I am and how I feel. So you can imagine the confusion when I had this male form of a body, which was totally alien to me. Puberty was a total nightmare. Puberty a nightmare? Anybody? No, come on. I'll tell you what, I'll ask that question in a couple of years and you'll have a different answer. I had to go through it twice, by the way, which is even more interesting. So gender identity, I think we hear a little bit more about that. No, we don't. We get on to gender pronouns. So gender identity talks to pronouns. Okay, so again, thank you for those who observed that I declared my pronouns on the title slide. So typically here we see that we have he and she pronouns. That conforms to the gender binary. I actually would have preferred to see this one up, but the singular they is a perfectly valid singular pronoun that is gender neutral. We use it all the time, even though we may not think about it. And it was used by the likes of Shakespeare, Oscar Wilde, and other authors. And it also shows up in the Oxford English Dictionary as well as in Webster's. They is a perfectly usable and manageable pronoun for somebody that does not identify on the gender binary and conform to the concept of just simply he and she. And then ZZ and Z come from German origins, but also talk to non-binary genders. It's interesting, my wife is Ukrainian. She speaks Russian, Ukrainian, and German, English, and Slovene. So she's a translator with us at Sanctuary. And it's interesting that we have struggles. The Russian is a very gendered language, even more strongly gendered than French and German, and has a real problem with a singular they. It just doesn't exist in Russian language. Gender pronouns.
Pul. Mislim, ime je res uporaben, je bolj nickname, okay, iz osnovne šole še. Pomeni pa po kitajsko novo rojstvo. Tako da mogoče zaradi tega mi je ta ime pač toliko všeč. Za Int'l, ja, mislim, da zmeri pomeni, da je on zdaj karkoli bo drugega, ne, valjda, mi je bo nelagodno.
Najbolj me muti, če me pač kdo pokliče po starem imenu ali pa, na primer, ženskih zaimkih, nekako pač mi izbije, da se samo zove, če mi zdaj, ne, pač govorijo mi, da kot z Jakobom ali pa kot s fantovskim zaimkim.
Moje ime mi veliko pomeni, spustila sem ga istega, saj namreč v arabščini pomeni kamen, kar sporoča, da sem trden oziroma trdna. Zaimke menjam, se pravi moški in ženski, ona, on.
Tu v slovenščini se ne počutim tako udobno, zato ker je zelo spolno zaznamovan jezik, v bistvu samo z dvema opcijama.
Zaimki mi pomenijo ful losti, pomenijo pa mi v bistvu ogromno stisk in ogromno svobode. Svobode v tem, da uporabljam jezik tako, kot ni bilo morda mišljeno, da se ga uporablja, zaradi tega, ker ga uporabljam na nebinarni način, ker je moja identiteta nebinarna. Hkrati pa stisko zaradi tega, ker razen v majhnih krogih so moji zaimki ponavadi nelegitimirani ali pa tarča posmeha.
Zaimki mi pomenijo veliko, no, prizadane me zelo, če me še vidno in po mojem do konca življenja me bojo klicali v moškem rodu in me to prizadane. Prizadane me izključno zaradi tega, ker ljudje so nerazgledani. Ime mi pomeni veliko. Končno sem si izbrala ime, katere meni paše, ne, kada mi je moji starši zbrali, ne?
Pronouns are important to us, right? They're a key part of our identity and how we interact with each other as people. If you're ever in any doubt about somebody's pronouns, what are you going to do? Ask. Yes. Just ask. Just ask. And, you know, if I just say, oh, it's she, you know, can't you tell? Well, that would not be a very polite response to a polite question of asking. So think about asking pronouns. While I just think about it, the first person in that clip, dear friend Aoi, a very brave, courageous trans man, he wrote to me yesterday. He's currently being pursued by bullies in the country. He's fearing for his life. right now as a result of transphobia. The police cannot do anything unless an actual incident occurs. So there is nothing against bullying on the part of gender identity or expression in Slovenia. So he would have to be beaten up before the police can intervene. So he and his partner are now taking self-defense classes and probably moving in order to try and protect themselves and to evade the pursuit of the bullies. It's just tragic that that came to our attention here on Day of Pink. Okay, so we've checked off biological sex, we've checked off gender identity. Now let's get on to gender expression. So our gender expression, sitting in here, is how we show up in the world, right? So this is where it gets interesting. Now I can't remember if there's a clip here or not. So if there is, let's hear about gender expression, and then I'll talk about it in a little bit more detail.
Pomemben. Saj doživljam disforijo od malih let, prav okoli 5 let sem začela doživljati ta občutek, za katerega ime sem zvedela šele zelo kasneje. In sedaj mi zelo pomaga, da lahko pač z oblekami, z make-upom in z vsemi pač na splošno pripomočki si olajšam ta občutek. Ne,
ja, zelo pač rad vidim jo video kot fanta, da pač pesem res, tako se zagri. Tako da pač ne moram make-upa, nikoli ga nečem, sem ga imel, sem mi ni bilo všeč, tako da mora biti fantasko vločila.
Mi je bil včasih bolj. Včasih mi je bil ful bolj, mislim to, da sem pazil, ne, tudi kaj oblečem, ali čim ki všeč pa mi je bilo, to ne boli jih izražal me, a ne, pol tega pač nisem oblekel. Ampak danes pa, pač sem, kar sem, no. Ni niti nobena definicija tega.
Zelo pomembno. V bistvu z mojimi oblačili izražam, kaj mi je udobno, v čem se počutim udobno in ja, to mi je zelo pomembno, da se lahko izražam pač na takšen način, ko meni paše, ne pa ko bi, na primer, okolica pričakovala ali pa tako podobno.
So, our gender expression. So, in my case, this is where it got interesting, right? Because my gender expression for the first half of my life was masculine. I was dressing up as a guy for the longest time just because that was how I could get on in a society where transphobia existed, where transgender was not a common term, was certainly not something that I understood at the time, and I just needed to live within society. And so that's how I got away with it. But it was oppressive, and it was oppressive to me. It was not comfortable, it was not right. I never, not one day in my life, felt good during that time. Since transition, of course, it's an entirely different story, and now I feel completely at peace and liberated. So our gender expression is very important. Now, what's also important to note, and you would have caught it from a couple of the people in the clip, was that gender expression is not one or the other. It might be a bit of both, or it might be none at all. So our gender expression is completely variable on both of these axes, and is again as unique to us as a pebble on a beach. Okay, so we've done identity, we've now expressed ourselves in our gender, but at no point here have we talked about relationships. Have we talked about sexuality, sexual orientation, or romantic attraction? And that's where we're going to go next. So there's two aspects to this. Who we might be romantically attracted to can be, for some of us, distinct from who we might be sexually attracted to. So here's an example. Asexuality is a situation where my sexual orientation is neither male or female, I'm actually not interested in sex at all. But I am interested in having a close romantic relationship. So there's an example where these two are actually separated from each other. Similarly, we might have pansexuality or even bisexuality. Both of those might infer a preference in terms of sexual orientation, but would be very definite about who they would want to be romantically involved in. And I can give you an example. I have a dear friend of mine who is bisexual, enjoys sexual relations with both male and female partners, and non-binary partners for that matter, actually. But would only ever think about having a day-to-day romantic integrated relationship with a woman. So there's an instance where these two are separate. So we've really covered, and I'm whizzing along here for time, so we've really covered this. The genderbread person takes care of our gender identity and our expression, and it's distinct from our sexual orientation. And as I mentioned earlier on, right, when I introduced myself, as a trans woman, I am lesbian. I've been attracted to women all my life, always have been, always will. Sorry guys, but you're just not my thing.
Njihov problem, se ne ukvarjam s takimi ljudmi, jaz vedno sam, kaj sam, pomembno je, da sem jaz srečna, za njih me briga.
Nobena manjšinska osebna okoliščina ne more biti modna muha, ker prinese za sabo nerazumevanje, ker prinese za sabo nasilje, ker prinese za sabo nevidnost in ljudje si ne bi nikakor nikoli tega zbirali, to pač smo.
Glede ljudi, ki ne priznavajo moje spolne identitete, lahko rečem samo, da se lahko za 180 stopinj obrnejo in grejo.
Da se itak jaz sam bolj poznam kot me oni in da mi bi bilo zelo všeč, da bi me vsaj spoštovali drug, da bi imel poštevali.
Mislim, zdaj, ker jaz se takimi ljudmi jih ne ukvarjam oziroma jih niti nijam v življenju, ampak če bi že bili, a ne, mislim, da bi bilo, da najmanj, kar ne lahko naredijo, je, da te vsaj probajo spoznati. Ker mislim, jaz tam je nekaj ljudi, ki so bili taki transfobi, a ne, tako dosti bolj dobri prijatelji. Zato, ker pa sem dal šanso, da me spoznajo in vidijo, da nisem čisto drugačen, ker pa do kolikor drug, ne. Tako da mogoče sam to pač dajo priložnost. Vse in nam, ne.
So, hey, at the end there, so he was the guy that's currently being bullied. He really said it succinctly. So he had some transphobic friends in his peer circle. Now, he could have made the choice and said, ignore them, I don't want to be associated. But instead what happened is he brought them along as allies. Over time, they understood how he was feeling and have now become close friends with him. Because he, like me, just keeps showing up in our gender identity and our gender expression. And so I hope what I've done here is I shared with you all of these variables, and it is a variable. There's this big spectrum around gender identity. There's even a spectrum around sexual orientation. But the key point here is that every single one of them, just like every single pebble, is perfectly valid. You do not need to explain yourself to anybody. You are you. You are who you feel. You express yourself as you wish. You are an individual. So a recap to the path of acceptance. Visibility. Just like all of the people in the film who just keep showing up. And by the way, we shot each clip in the hometown or village of the individual. Right? This is an important thing because so many trans people find they have to move away from their area for fear of discrimination and prejudice and hatred and bullying. Visibility leads to awareness. Awareness leads to understanding, which in turn leads to acceptance and ultimately... I heard a whisper of an ally. Okay. Allies is the right answer. Allies, yes! Let's hear it for allies!
In da je spoštljiv, da če kaj ne ve vpraša, ne domneva. Zelo simpel.
Naj nas enostavno posluša in nas podpira, kjer lahko, koga prosimo in naj ne govori v imenu nas.
Uporabi svoj glas, svoj privilegij, v tem smislu, v tem primeru gre za cis-spolne privilegije in nam ponudi platformo v drugih prostorih, tako da bomo slišane.
Nič za nas, brez nas. Torej, če nekdo je zaveznik oziroma zaveznica, je to takrat, ko vključuje transspolne osebe na svojih dogodkih, v svojih dokumentih, naredi vključujoča stranišča, karkoli, pač razmišlja o tem, da obstajajo tudi transspolne osebe in svoje delo, svoje življenje, svoj aktivizem, svoj poklic, karkoli, poskuša prilagoditi temu, da se nas ne izključi.
Nasploh, kaj pa lahko, oziroma kje bi lahko pomagal, je na primer recimo zaveščanje. Kar se tiče, na primer, jaz sem bila v šoli, jaz nikoli nisem slišala, ne vem, o drugačni spolni usmerjenosti, kot pa je heteroseksualnost ali pa o različnih spolnih identitetah. In tu bi jaz rekla, da je to sigurno na tem področju bi se moralo delati, da se tudi ozavešča, da se o tem javno govori, ne vem, na šolah ali pa kje druge, da se vključuje vse ljudi.
Živi in pusti živeti. Ukvarjaj se svojim življenjem in stojim. To je osnova za dobro življenje tebe in drugih.
So Casse said it really well in there, right? Visibility. In school, when she was going through school, she had no idea about trans. The only discussion that was ever had was one around heterosexuality and cisnormativity and cisgender. Okay, so we're whizzing on really quickly here. Next steps, what can we do? So this is something that I created as I've gone on my journey, and it talks to the pebble, right? But it starts with us, right? Michael Jackson, The Man in the Mirror. Anybody hear that song? Right? Change starts with us. We can't change other people. We might be able to influence them in some way, we might be able to educate them in some way, but we can't actually change anybody, nor can we make anybody else happy. Only we can do that. So it always starts with us. So if we can, you and me, every one of us, if we can come to acknowledge, love, and respect our own uniqueness, our own pebble, right? Then just maybe, we can learn to respect the uniqueness of others. We can love all the pebbles on the beach just because they are. Not because they have to be anything, but just because they are. I want to thank you all very much for your attention. Thank you. If you would like to reach out, please do. There's a few contact details there. There's a million more. Unfortunately, I didn't list them all, but you can certainly get to me there.
Sing a song.
Sing a song. That's the next slide. Good, I like it. But in order to earn a song, we're going to take questions. Anybody have questions? Absolutely anything that I covered. I think I have a few minutes here before I have to let you go. Anybody? Anybody with a question? Yes?
Did you have any trouble with friends or family, like having to do with
transphobia? Oh, absolutely. Yes, so, you know, what happened to me is that I lost all of my family and I lost some friends. I'll tell you an interesting story. So, in my coming out year, what I did was I did a lot of theatre work, right? So, I was working in a theatre in the GTA and it was coming up to the new season. So, my transition took an entire year. It started in January and finished at the beginning of December. And in the middle of that was the new theatre season. Theatre season starts in August. Before that, it's dark through the summer, everybody's on vacations. And I decided that year that I didn't want to start the theatre season in my duality. Instead, I wanted to reveal Michelle to my friends and colleagues in the theatre. And somehow in my mind, so what did I do? So I sent them all an email with a photograph of me and a little description and a couple of my phrases, including answering any question respectfully asked. I took a big deep breath and I hit the send button and off it went to everybody. And I drove into the theatre the following day and I was scared. But I had also, in my mind, decided who was going to come with me on the journey and who wasn't going to accept me for who I was. I got it wrong. I got it totally, totally wrong. Everyone that I thought would just embrace me and bring me along and say, well, we've got your back, we've got you. They kind of took a step back and went, oh. And everyone that I was convinced, particularly particularly the older generation, this was really curious, would not come with me on the journey. Bought in cards and chocolate. I had so much chocolate in the tech booth that night. It was wonderful. We do lose people on the way. Some people come back to us, but we have to also be able to let them go. They maybe just don't get it. And it depends on the circle of influence. So if people are in your first circle of influence, immediate family, very, very close, bestest friends, people like that, they're invested in the relationship, so they've got more to lose. As you get further out in your circles of influence, where there's less investment in the relationship, there's less to lose, it tends to be a little easier for those people. Anybody else? Oh, one back there somewhere. Yes. Originally, so I was born about 1 hour north of London, England, and I moved here in 2004, and now consider myself Canadian. I do. I love Canada. Just love it. I travel a lot, but it's always good to come home, and this is home. Anybody else? Yes. Did I start taking estrogen? Absolutely. So that was the first thing that happened. It had been January of 2011. Was hormone therapy, right? And so that's kind of the first step. So let's get rid of that testosterone, which is yucky stuff, and the cause of so much trouble, let me tell you. And added estrogen and progesterone, yeah, as a treatment, under the management, careful management of a doctor. That's very, very important, because hormones, as you're coming to discover, are really powerful chemicals in our bodies, so you have to be really careful when you're doing anything around hormone therapy. Anyone else? One at the back there.
What's the chance of moving back in your hometown?
Honestly, I don't know. And the reason for that is I was still in the closet when I was back in England, and I didn't come out until 2011, some 7 years after I got here. But what I do know from fellow activists is that the climate is not as liberal, not as accepting as it is here in Canada. You know, on the whole, we're very lucky here to have, generally speaking, an environment that's safe, but also one that is supported from the top down, right? So Premier Trudeau, his government, the LGBT minister that has that in his portfolio, Rene, you know, just awesome people. I think I have time for one more. Can I squeeze one more in? Up the back there.
Are you genuinely overall happy with
it? Yeah.
Why is it not looking
more towards
it?
Are you
comfortable
and happy? Totally. Totally. Do you feel it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Isn't that awesome? I would never have done this before, by the way. Never. Not a chance. Right? Absolutely. And why? Because there's this whole burden has been lifted off of me. You know, all this baggage that I was carrying, all of this internalized transphobia, actually, and homophobia, right? So this often happens within the LGBT community, is that we can be our worst homophobes. And so that has to be dealt with. And so that took a lot. Okay, so I think I'm running out of time because I need to be able to let you guys go. So I'm going to once again say thank you very much, and I'm going to play a song as you go out. Before the applause, just 1 second, because I'm not going to get the chance to do this, I know. So this song came to me. You know, people come into our lives for a reason, right? They do. Sometimes we don't have to search them out. Sometimes they just show up. And Angie Nasi is a singer-songwriter from Orillia, down the street. We met in Milton, Ontario, at an engagement last year. We were both performing. And she sang a song which I just loved. And I was in the final stages of editing the film. And in fact, it was done. I was mastering it. But I heard her song and I decided it had to be the closing song for the film. And she very graciously allowed me to do that. And so I used that song. It's Quiet Room from the album Still Hope. But the very key lyric in there is the chorus of Stand Up. And I'm going to ask you all to stand up as we sing this song and as we leave, because it's just truly phenomenal. So hang on just a second, because I think something else is going to happen first, and then we'll play the song as we leave the theatre. Once again, thank you all for your attention. Love it. Thank you.
just wanted to offer a gift for represent our gratitude for you coming here today and talking to us. So yeah, the song.
Bothered in the times when it can't protect you somewhere.